In this next series of video lectures, we're going to start covering input and output in Java programs. But first, let's start with a quick overview of the motivations for having I/O in the first place, and a roadmap of where we'll be going. Okay, let's get started. So up to this point, many of the simple programs we've looked over and have created have had hardwired or fixed data inputs. These kind of programs are great for teaching purposes, but I think we can easily agree that they're not terribly useful in real life. After all, if we have to add some numbers together or compute a sales tax, for example, having to edit some hardwired numbers and recompile our program each time is just not practical or realistic. In programming, we always prefer general solutions to specific solutions, so we need some ways of reading in user-specified input values at runtime, and as always, displaying back any results. This, in essence, is the input-output, or I/O, problem. In general, there are multiple possible ways to handle I/O in our programs. The actual means that we choose to use depends on the specifics of the situation, or perhaps on our program constraints, or practically speaking, upon our own familiarity with the various possible means of I/O. This list is by no means complete, but here is a short list of some possible I/O options. The command line, pop-up GUI dialogs, GUI windows, web pages, touch screens, mobile devices, file I/O, database I/O, or network I/O. Other CS courses here at the college can and do get into most of these possible alternatives, but in this course, owing to our schedule constraints, we are going to focus on the one shown in bold. So for us, command line I/O from the keyboard and to the screen, pop-up GUI dialog components, and briefly later in the course, a little bit of file I/O. Now, I/O capability in a program is great in general because it makes our programs much more general purpose and hence more useful. However, adding I/O capability adds some new considerations and potentially opens these cans of worms for us. For example, now we also need to think in terms of designing in defensive programming. We may need to check that any user inputs are proper, correct, and complete. If they're not, we want to make sure that any bad inputs won't crash our program. We accomplish this kind of checking through the use of logic and exception handling, which we'll get to later in the course, but just realize that this adds more complexity and length to our programs. You might have heard about defensive programming under other names, such as bulletproofing, user-safing, or perhaps less charitably, idiot-proofing a program. Then once you've added this kind of checking to your program, you then might run into somewhat philosophical testing considerations, such as, how do we know whether or not we've tested our program's I/O capability enough? How can we be sure that we've tested all the reasonable possibilities for bad data and an adequate sampling of the unreasonable possibilities? What does our program do when it encounters bad data, or badly formatted, or incomplete, or out of bounds data? Does it handle the error gracefully? Does it notify the user? Or does it simply crash on us? These are all kind of open-ended concerns, but they are very real in programming. Adding this kind of safety takes time and effort and increases the size of our programs. We don't have all the tools needed yet to do this kind of checking, and we won't concern ourselves with it too much in this course, but I just want to give you some real-world sense of what you might need to consider in your programs down the road when you add I/O capability to them. In this course, and in the next few lecture segments, we're going to focus our attention on these two workhorse I/O classes, Scanner and JOption Pane, which are compared here. We've already used the Scanner class in our programs, but we'll be looking at it in a little more detail now. The JOption Pane class will be a new class for us. We'll be using the Scanner class for user input only, but the JOption Pane class can be used for input, output, or both. Both these classes are found in packages external to the core Java, so they both must be imported to be used. Scanner as java.util.scanner and JOptionPane as javax.swing.JOptionPane. The JavaX Swing package, by the way, is home to many useful GUI element classes. Scanner is an example of the more typical object-based classes. We would declare a new scanner object, then make use of its various methods to read input of any specified core data type. By contrast, JOptionPane contains static methods, which of course means that we call those methods coupled with the name of the class itself. Both classes, to do their jobs, require us to provide text prompts to the user. For Scanner, the prompt is printed using system.out.print or println, preceding the data read. For JOptionPane, the prompt is provided as an input argument to the static method call. Scanner then reads user input only from the command line via the keyboard, whereas JOption pane can read inputs or display outputs, and these are done via pop-up GUI dialog elements. This last item is a key difference between the classes. When we read in user input data with Scanner, the data is already of some primitive data type or a string. But when we work with JOption pane, all of its inputs or outputs are of string type, so if we want to do anything with these, we typically must type convert them first using the wrapper classes, which we discussed in a prior lecture. This last diagram summarizes our general I/O capabilities for this course and shows the various pathways we'll consider for program I/O using the Scanner and JOption pane classes. For the command line input, we'll rely on the Scanner class. We'll instantiate a new Scanner object, shown here in blue, and then use the various next methods to read in specific data types. For command line or screen output, we'll simply use system.out.println as we've been doing over and over again. For GUI input or output, we'll see how to use these two methods of the JOption pane class, which will be called statically using the name of the class as shown here in red. Remember that we may also need to transform any strings into core data types, and for that, we'll also make use of the wrapper classes. Finally, we'll also see how to control the output representation of any program variables, using either system.out.printf or string.format. If you're familiar with C, printf is exactly like the printf method found in that language. The difference between these two is that printf actually prints formatted data, whereas format simply formats and returns a formatted string for display by some other means. The similarity between these two is that they both rely upon the concept of a format specifier, which we'll examine soon. For example, both of these will help us to numerically truncate the display of any excess decimal place garbage resulting from some finite representation floating point calculations. Okay, so with this as our general roadmap for handling program I/O, let's start getting into some of these details and looking at some examples.